Hey there. Well, welcome to church. Oh my golly, when we were making the call, it was such a difficult call. But when we were considering everything, my family, we just needed to make sure we made the right decision. So people are doing okay. There's some, you know, minor things going on as far as their physical health. We got several people, both on in the congregation, but also on the worship team, of which we felt that it was significant enough and close enough that it would not be a good thing for us to kind of push ourselves into a service where people are touching people. And so for this particular Sunday, we're just doing this. It's a one-time deal. We are looking to be back the following Sunday to a full-on live service with community kids, etc. So please forgive us for making that decision, but honestly, it was really to the best interest of you, our church family, as well as our community. We're going to get through it, and when we get through it, we'll be better for it, for sure. And that I'm so grateful for. That brings me to another thing, and that is that due to the timing of the COVID positives, it made it so difficult for us to be able to do a live in-house person as well as online week of prayer and fasting. And again, we felt that it would be to the best interest because we believe in the week of prayer and fasting. By the way, it's not really about when we have it during this season or time of year, whatever. It really is about our doing it. So we've set aside, February 7th, which is Monday, that whole week, we are going to do our prayer and fasting. So here's a couple of things we're hoping, and if everything continues to go well, during that week, we're going to have somebody who's going to be especially sharing in a prophetic sense. And we're also going to do baptisms during one of the nights that we're here together. So just kind of be on the lookout for that, and know that as we approach it, we will keep our keen eye, as leaders need to, for the full safety. You know, there's a lot of things I want to do. There's some things I can't do, and there's other things that I shouldn't do. And what we shouldn't do is press it. And I understand that there are people who have different feelings on that, and that is quite okay. We're certainly not going to buck against that. But just as we would honor your thoughts on these matters, please honor this leadership's decision-making in these matters, because there's nothing for us to gain, and there's everything for us to look forward to when we're all back together again. So I'm going to have a word of prayer, and I'm going to continue on the final parts of the Jabez prayer, and I'll pick up on some points, and then we're going to launch in to its conclusion, and then I'll be picking up on some other things that will be marching us towards this week of prayer and fasting. And by the way, this week of prayer and fasting is imperative and important, and I'm going to ask you to make sure that you put that on your calendars. All team leaders, that week we will definitely be shutting down, because we want the concentration of our church family to be in that place of prayer as well as in fasting. So we're going to be teaching along those lines towards that, so that we are prepared, so that when we step into that place, we will be fully warned, if you will. So please write that down on your calendars and set that aside and time. It's going to be a wonderful time, a great time, I can assure you. There's one other thing. I'm going to kind of make a little push here, because this afternoon there will be another session. I'm doing my what they call the video for the afternoon crowd. It's one I haven't done in a while, but this particular message, though, however, is I want to say it's a hard message. It was difficult for me to do it, as it will be difficult for you to hear it. In that message, I am dealing with some things concerning 2022 in the area of positioning ourselves and stepping out of some things that, quite frankly, that many of us have been walking in. And I will be addressing some of those things this particular afternoon, and then I'll do a follow-up the following Sunday afternoon. So if you want to, by the way, if you start it, please listen all the way through, because it's real important that you don't get a piece of the message, but you get the whole message. That way, when you walk away from there, you are fully informed. I believe you'll be encouraged, and I'm hoping that there'll be a fire of passion that would be ignited, and if not increased, in your heart. So please, would you consider doing that? That would be really awesome. That's at 3 o'clock. You can get there from through our webpage on the Facebook part, and I believe it will eventually show up on the YouTube as well. So just be ready. It is a stronger word, and I am going after some things. So just to be encouraged, but I'm doing it in love with passion. Okay. So we're just going to open up right now with a word of prayer, and then we're just going to step into this for the next few moments. Could we do that? So Father, as we just pause for a moment to say thank you for the privilege of this. And while we cannot be together in person, hugging one another and singing alongside one another, one thing is for sure, we can join in spirit together, especially for this short season of time. We do pray. We stop and we pause to pray for those who are among us, who are going through the COVID thing and the different variances that are out there. We just pray your health and strength upon them, that if they are in the midst of it, that there would be a quickened healing. If they were just exposed, that there will be no fruitation of that. And that Father, that we would be full, a church that's full of health and wholeness, so that we would once again join together. I love you, and I thank you so much for our time. And I give you the praise and the honor and the glory in Jesus' name. And y'all said amen and amen. Okay, so last week and the week before, we kind of touched on the area of the Jabez prayer. And if you care to know a little bit more about the history, you can go back to number one. And there's a portion of number two, of which I'm not going to go and readdress those things, only because I want to keep this in a time space with you. So I'd like for you, though, I am going to read that scripture again, because I think it's important for us to keep hearing the scriptures, so that we're being saturated in the word. There's so much to be said about that. 1 Chronicles chapter 4 and verse 9 and 10. And here's what it says in the New King James Version. It says this: Now Jabez was more honorable than his brothers. History is a couple sessions before this. And his mother called his name Jabez, saying, Because I bore him in pain. And Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, Oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me, and that you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. So God granted him what he requested. So important. God will grant, he will grant you the answer to your prayer. I cited last week a statement that Smith Wigglesworth said, and it says this: God is more eager to answer than we are to ask. God is more eager to answer than we are to ask. So I'm giving you basically four points. The first one I tapped into a bit last week. And the number one is, and if you're taking notes, it would be four vital points of Jabez's prayer. Prayers that we can pray ourselves and know that we're praying in alignment with the scriptures. So important for us to understand that. So many times we, and I'm as guilty, oftentimes we pray selfish. Lord, I need, but our needs are really our wants. But if we could just look into the scripture and see how the saints of God prayed and watched their lives, you would see an unfolding that their prayers aligned with the heart, the will, and the purposes of God. So it wasn't just in the area of just the needs or the wants, but it was really more so, it was about the overall need for God to be real in people's lives, to pour His love, His life, and His word into the hearts of, in the lives of people. And so that's kind of where I want to hang out a little bit, because it's real important for us to get. If we want to pray, and we want answers to prayer, and we want the blessings of those answers, then we need to know how to pray. Isn't that what the disciples asked? Jesus, teach us how to pray. And then, of course, Jesus taught them how to pray. Paul prayed. Now, here we have Jabez, which is in the Old Testament, but nonetheless very, very appropriate for the day that we're living. Isn't that weird that something that could be prayed so long ago could still be relevant for today? That just says there's just nothing new under the sun. So number one, I said, and for your notes, it's pray with hope and faith. Remember, I talked about hope. Hope is the expectation. It's not just hopefulness, right? And then we talked about faith. We just dealt with that a little bit. But there were some things in specific that I didn't really get into last week that I really want to delve into right now with you, if I could. So in under that heading, oh, that you would bless me. What were the things that I believe that are a part of where we are and what we need to and how we need to be praying? And one of them is to pray for fulfillment and the sense of realized destiny. That the will and the purposes of God would be fulfilled in our lives as well as other people's lives. That should be a prayer. See, our hope, our expectation, and our faith is going after the things that we don't necessarily see and those spiritual things, and we're asking God to make them real and relevant and a part of our lives so that people will see it and know that this Jesus is for real and that God does love them. Most people don't believe that because, well, we don't necessarily treat them like that. They're not as valued even in our words and our responses to maybe disagreements or whatever. So when we're praying, our prayer needs to be. I want to say in circling around things like fulfillment, that our fullness and the fulfillment of our life would be found in, out, and through Him. And that truly is, when that happens, and as God is doing that, and because He's going to answer the prayer, right? That's what we read at the end there in verse 10, that in that fulfillment, that adequacy of who we are in that fulfillment, that we will walk in a way that is literally with the expectation and faith of our destiny, that you and I have a destiny. We have a destiny. We're going somewhere. This is not the end. This is not our home. This is just our passing through. But our passing through has to mean something. So when we pray, just as Jabez was praying, we're praying that not only that we have the fulfillment in the sense, but that we have a sense of the realized destiny in God and His will for our life. So I have a destiny. You have a destiny. I heard it one time, and I shared this a while back. There was a guy that was praying that there's no such thing as destiny. That is not the word of God. You have a destiny. Now, the decision of our fulfilling that destiny is really found first in our prayer lives. We need to pray that God would enable us and help us. See, if I try to do it my natural, I'm going to mess it all up and I'll never get there because it's a supernatural thing. It's a supernatural process and it's a supernatural ending. And so when you pray, we're not only praying that we would have a sense of fulfillment, but that we would also have a realized position and disposition that we have a destiny, that we are called of God, and that we have a home that is being prepared for us, that has been prepared for us, so that when we leave here, as Paul said, to be absent from the body is to be in the presence of the Lord. And so these are the things God is building in us, but we need to pray. Pray is that not just a dialogue, but it's also in the identification. You see, if it's like anything else, if I hang around a rich person, I'll pick up things that a rich person does, and hopefully if I practice them and I'm smart, I will be rich too. There's things about rubbing off on one another. When we get close to God, He rubs off on us, and we do become like His image. But it really does begin with prayer, because prayer is that access, that place where there's relationship established and well built and built upon and encouraging on what took place at the cross, as well as the coming of the Holy Spirit, preparing us for the day when He comes. It's for the things that are promised in the Word of God. I love it, man. So many people are so good at repeating like a parrot of the promises of God's Word. And they memorize them. But the question is, are they real? Well, the real part, anything in God that is made real in us really begins in that position called prayer. Prayer is imperative. It is not an option. It is very much like if you're going to maintain your health, if you're going to maintain your strength, then you're going to eat healthy. So you got to go to the dinner table and you got to eat healthy. And by eating healthy, you are nourishing your body, and your body then is able to perform the things that you want to do, that you need to do, that's good for you to do, as for you as well as for others. Well, that's very much the same principle in the spiritual realm, that our spiritual lives really are only as strong and good and healthy as what we are participating in. That's in our eating. And our eating, in this case, is the lifestyle of prayer. And not just the realization of our destiny and the fulfillment of God, but the promises of His Word are yes and amen. But if we're not in a position to be able to receive that nourishment, that healthiness, we've missed the boat. So important. Or again, this is under number one, pray with hope and faith. For we should pray for those goals, those desires or aspirations prophesied or dreamed, spoken by the Holy Spirit. You know, and I this is where I think in a way we've missed something, and I don't think it's forever. I think it's a matter of our turning the ship and going after that. We've had so many prophetic words that have been given to this fellowship. I mean, defined, definitive, clear, directive, prophesied words by real men of God, confirmed by men and women of God who aren't even a part of this fellowship and have no clue, but they're saying the same. They were saying the same thing. One from England, one now he's from Florida, all right? Well, we love him still. And then others that have come in and they spoke in the Word, and from Elam, I mean, they spoke the Word and shared with us what God was speaking, and they were all around many of the same things. And I think where we missed it was that we took them and we said, yes, 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 glory to God. We sang and we celebrated, but what we didn't do is we didn't pray over them. We didn't seek the Lord on behalf of those things. We didn't align ourselves, because our alignment is not necessarily just our knowledge, but mainly it's really our knees. You see, because prayer not only matters, but it excites even God. So it not only draws us to Him, but it draws Him to us. So it's important for us to understand that there are aspirations and there are things, but they're watered by the Holy Spirit. But that's through prayer, when we learn how to pray. So Jabez understood that when he prayed with hope and faith, it was directed on specifics. Just like you and me today, we need to direct our faith and our hope in prayer on specifics. That God has, some of you have had dreams, some of you have had visions, some of you have had words spoken over your life and even in your life by others through circumstances and situations. But what really hammers it into us, that it really is totally fulfilled through us, is when we learn how to pray in hope, which is expectation and faith. Without not seeing it now, but when we believe it and we walk therein, we will see, just as Hebrews 11 says so. Number two, ask God to expand and recover. That's exactly Jabez was saying here. He said, enlarge my tent, my territory. By enlarging my territory, I have more capacity. Your territory can be your person, the place that you inhabit, the atmosphere, your home, your church, should be in the church, your wherever. That when we pray and we ask God that He would not only enlarge, that He would enlarge our territory, but with the understanding of that enlargement, it means to recover and to restore as well as to enlarge. There are things that you have lost in your journey because of distractions, because of growing weary, because of prayerlessness, whatever those reasons why it's not happening. God is saying to you and to me that access point for that recovering of what was lost and the restoration to what has been diminished can happen through a heart that is seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And then it says, and all of these things will be added to you. You see, he wants to recover what the locusts have eaten. He wants to recover what you've lost. Just because you've lost it doesn't mean it has to stay lost. But listen, when we get a hold of the heart of God and we become intimate with Him through the developing of our and the working of our prayer lives, we then, my friends, find the fullness and the fulfillment of God's workings in our life. Because everything is not just for us, but it's also for the sake of others' lives who are touched by us. That's important. Here's number three. Ask the Lord to defend and expel. Here's what he says. Here's what Jabez says. That you would keep me from evil, that I might not cause pain. Let me just read a little caption that I have in my notes just so that we can track together. Jabez asks Lord's defense not only for his own sake, but to expel the residue of any evil in him. How many understand, just because I accepted the Lord, just because you accepted the Lord, doesn't mean you've arrived. That you're never gonna, you don't have to worry about it anymore. It's all done. No, there's residue. There are habits. There are things that have been developed out of a life and a lifestyle influenced and run by sin. The residue. So here's what it says. Jabez asks for the Lord's defense, not only for his own sake, but to expel the residue of any evil in him that would inhabit God's purpose, inhibit God's purpose for his life or becoming painful to others. That is, things that tempt, attack, or haunt you. Things that tempt you, that attack you, and haunt you. Haunt your mind. Fill your mind. things from your past, maybe your parents or your heritage or what was done. And I've said many times, I'll say it many more times, things that were spoken over you, things that were beat into you by friends or enemies or whatever, you see? Things that condemn you or confuse you or brought compromising to you. Listen. He is the greatest of deliverers in these things. You will get nothing better than Him interceding and standing in and washing those things away. But let me tell you something. It doesn't come with a prayer, a wish, and a moment. It comes when you are seeking after Him, pursuing Him, when you're not intimidated by those things that have been doing you in, those chains that have bound you, but it's when you press forward and you will not stop until. See, this is what praying and defending and expelling those things, defending you as in Christ, that you are and you belong to Christ. The expelling is that, God, that you would create in me a clean heart, not just once, but for the rest of my days. That as we seek and He exposes things that are a part of our sinful, fallen character and nature, and we're carrying those things that have been weighing us down. When we get into that place of praying for God to rule and to reign in a defensive matter, expelling those things that have denied His full access. It's time, church. God is calling you out of where you were into what He has prepared for you to be. You see, those are the things that Jabez was praying. It wasn't just so that we could just recite and put it into a common book of prayer. It is, these things not only were relevant to him in his life, but they're relevant to you and to me. That we would not only walk and pray in hope and faith, that we would believe him, but that we would recover what was lost and has been eaten by the locust. And that we would be full and filled with him through our seeking and our exposing of ourselves through prayer, that he would expel those things that have been tearing you apart. That he would be tearing you apart. And finally, number four, and I'm done. Number four, believe that God will bless, recover, enlarge, and defend. Let me say that again. Believe that God will bless, recover, enlarge, and defend you. Look what it says at that very last part. It says, so God granted him what he requested. By the word, that word requested could sound like, in our terminology, well, we asked and God did it. He asked and God did it. No. There was something that was stemming or crying out from the very inner part of Jabez's heart and life. It was a prayer of desperation. It wasn't just a, you know, now I lay me sound asleep prayer. It was a cry out because there was no other hope for him. His lineage already was going to dictate how his life was going to be, and it wasn't going to be any of the things that he prayed for, yet everything he prayed for, he became. Tell me if that isn't love. My friends, wherever you are in these things, I want to tell you that God has not forsaken you. He loves you dearly. He cares for you. He has called you by name. He has prepared a place for you, not just in heaven, but abundant living here and now. But we must come to that place whereby we are hearing His voice. We're obedient to His word, and we're crying out of the realization that we are desperately in need of His intervention. And when we pray heart. When we pray sincerity. When we pray, we cry out. When we pray, we keep on praying. We keep on knocking. We keep on seeking. We keep on, whatever it is, we keep on going after Him. Let me tell you something. And God will grant you your desire. Why? Because it is in alignment with his heart, and it is a life of prayer that motivates. He's drawn, and we are broken in. We are broken deep. Our brokenness sets us up to be receiving of what he wants and has for us. I am so grateful for this time to be with you. I pray God's richest blessings to you. And I am really looking forward to next week. And be reminded, week of prayer and fasting is going to happen. And until then, I want you to know we love you. Looking forward to seeing you. And we will see you again very, very, very soon. God bless you.